Hello, good afternoon from Bangkok, and welcome everyone to Stay Healthy Doctor Talk from Bumrungrad International Hospital. I'm Dr. Suvarna, and now I'm here today with a still hot topic about the post-COVID complications. And I'm really excited that I have two guests today. The first one is going to be Dr. Chok Lim Suwat. He is our pulmonologist and our critical care specialist, which of course, by his title, we all know that he has take care of the patients in the ICU, and also after they were discharged from the hospital, we all know that there are some complications that cause the long COVID syndrome that we can hear in the news. And also with my another guest is Dr. Narinthorn Surasinthorn. Dr. Rinthorn is a medical director of Vital Life Rangkachao Project, and he is now in charge of taking care of the post-COVID patients as well. And now they both are going to give us like all the information that we have in providing the care so the post-COVID patient has go back to their normal lives, okay? I'm going to start with the first question now that maybe we will need a little bit of background that some of you might have know about the post-COVID complications or the long COVID syndrome or something like that. Can I ask Dr. Chok at this moment, since we know that lots of COVID patients has like their lungs involved and there's going to be like lung complications. Can you give us a overview of what the patient is going to face after they were just recovered from the COVID?
สวัสดีครับ. So good afternoon from Bangkok. From my perspective, I have seen good amount of COVID patients. Majority of them in my service, as Dr. Suvarna, she introduced, they're gonna be sick because some of them in the ICU. And as a pulmonologist, I got a consult for someone who's sick with a pneumonia or lung infection with COVID, right? So from past few years, we have been learn more and more in our hospitals and from the outside world too, what we should do and what happened after COVID. So I try to make a summarize on this slide. So actually this one is from the Nature. So anyway, when the patient have a COVID infections, majority of the patient, some of them don't have much symptom from beginning, but it doesn't mean that they doesn't have any something last long or called long COVID. And in my case, really, someone who have sick in a hospital, in the ICU, they tend to have more long COVID problems. After 3 months, which is really definition of the long COVID syndrome is count from the 12 week or 3 months. So they still have symptoms. So the majority of the patients, what did they complain, right? So majority of my patients, they complain with fatigue. And this is very difficult question for the clinician like pulmonologist to find out. So we're gonna need another doctor who taking care of this too. But in my perspective, when patients come with fatigue, I try to find out any problem related to fatigue. So we approach like normal patients. Are they having anemia? Are they have other illness? Are they have depressions? Anxiety, cannot sleep after COVID, right? And in my clinic, I pay more attention in the lung problem, which is everyone know that the COVID hit the lung really bad. And this is the majority of the patient who have the symptom is gonna be dyspnea or still have trouble breathing even after 3 months. Someone have a chest pain, chest tightness, they cannot take a deep breath. So this is the main issue in my clinic that I taking care. And in general, apart from what I told already, in patients with COVID, they can have other problems like skin lesions, kidney problem, cardiac problem, or increase the cardiac event too. So this is my perspective in my clinic, but part that I pay attention is, are they gonna have clot on the vein, any lung complication that can be fixed? But in other part, I need a good colleague to taking care too.
Which is here, right?
Yes.
talking about the lung complications, I would like to know how many of the percentage of the patients that was in the ICU they have lung involvement, and then after that, how many of them that would have like the symptoms of the lung afterwards?
So for the lung symptom, if we count for after 12 weeks, if we look at the study, the research, in China, they have a big research. They did their scan of the lung after 3 months already, when the patient have a COVID infections, at least 50% of them still have one of abnormal lung in the scan after that. Half of them.
That's quite a lot.
Yes, and then if we even count from another study that when the patient in the ICU or they're really sick in the hospital, up to 60 to 70% they still have chest symptom after 3 months, 60 to 70%. Yeah, and then if we count for just the scar or the fibrotic of the lung, which is the patient when they heal from the lung infections, part of the lung tissue. Could be back to normal, but some part could develop the scar, right? So if we count for how many percentage of the scar, it range between like 30 to 60% up to the study that they follow up.
So that's quite a lot then.
Yeah, that's quite a lot.
That's quite a lot. So some of the symptoms must be like from the lungs for sure, right? But well, there are going to be some of the patients that has the symptom, which is like maybe the rest, and they don't have like the lung fibrosis, the involvement, but they have like lots of symptoms that you were mentioning before. I think this is the one that Dr. Narinthorn will give us like the answer about the, in terms of your clinical practice, that you have seen patients with lots of symptoms, but maybe the chest x-ray are normal, the CAT scan are completely fine, but they're still like not okay, they are not normal yet. And is there other symptoms that you encounter a lot?
So what I take care of is about the quality of life. So in the research, it shows that the patient who have a post-COVID is about 10 to 20% of the one who have COVID. So 10 to 20% may have symptoms last until 6 months or more than that. And it's linked to the quality of life. It shows that in UK, is one paper showed that about 26% of the COVID patients, after 6 months, they cannot go back to work. So this have impact a lot because many symptoms that they have. In the brain, they have a mood swing, anxiety, depression, insomnia, and loss of taste, loss of smell. In the heart, tachycardia and chest pain. In the skin, have rash. Problem with pancreas can increase risk of diabetes. Someone have high liver enzymes, high kidney functions, abnormal kidney functions. So we go back, what is the mechanism behind that?
I was about to ask, is there any organ that doesn't have any effect from COVID? It doesn't have one.
It's because of it's linked to ACE receptor.
What receptor again?
It's a receptor that the COVID virus go into the cell.
I see.
So which organ that have an ACE receptor is can affect with that organ, that functions.
See.
Because when the virus go into that cell, the cell, ourselves can like to create the immune response. And when we have immune response to that virus, when it's too much, it's called cytokine storm. And this can create inflammation in the body and can create many symptoms in the body.
So it goes all over then.
Yes. So first it comes from inflammation. Second is come from hypoxia. Now when body cannot get enough oxygenation, then the mitochondria or the organ inside the cell cannot produce enough energy. That's why patients have fatigue. And the third is come from micro abnormal coagulations. So all of these three mechanisms create the symptom of post-COVID.
On the second note, with what you mentioned about mitochondria, you need some of us might need to go back to our biology class in our elementary school or something like that.
It's like the factory in our cell to produce energy.
Right, that's an easy way to put it. And the third one, is it like about the blood clots that we are talking about, right?
Yes. So we have the blood test that can assess that the patient have this condition or not. We have the blood test to check inflammation marker. We have the blood test like D-dimer to check coagulation state. We can do the lung function test or VO2 max to check the oxygenation of the body. And other tests like CT scan of the lung that Dr. Chok do in many cases and still have some spot or some scar in the lung, right?
Right, I see. So since it's like many, many organs that are involved, right. Actually there is not going to be any organ that doesn't involve at all. And then what we're going to do about it? Well, I guess there's going to be some question about the lung symptoms, so I'm going to send back to Dr. Chok here that some day before, we know that some lung fibrosis or scar is like when we have like a cut or the accident and then we have a scar, which is going to be there for the rest of our lives. What we can do for the scar that we have in our lungs?
Yeah, so first of all, I like to show the slide. When the patient have COVID, I think we talk about the lung involvement and fibrotic already. Most of the patient, they recover really well. They don't need much of help, but some of the patients really need help all along when they come to my clinic. And apart from what we talk about the lung tissue already in the airway, they still have problem too. Some of the patients with COVID, after COVID, they have chest tightness. Sometimes it's related with the, what we call in medical term is reactive airway. What does that mean? It means that the airway just have like narrowing and then they cannot get the air in and out easily. So that's why patients come with a chest tightness. Even though the patient doesn't have any lung problem before or never have what we call asthma before, they can still develop this reactive airway. And I see a lot in my clinic. So the way we treat the patients, we evaluations, are there any airway problems? Are there any lung tissue problems? And then we treat it all together, right? Mm-hmm. And another thing is like patient with COVID, I think whoever get through the COVID really bad, they will know that they get a lot of medication to suppress the immune.
Right.
Because as Dr. Nalin Khan, he said, when the COVID hit the body just like, some people just overreact of the immunization and then kind of like destroy ourselves, right? Mm. So that's why they have to, we have to treat them with the immunosuppressive. After immunosuppressive, of course, infection come, right? So I'm gonna walk through the patient two cases that come to my my clinic, and we take care of the patients. So the audience will see what do we do here to recover the patients. So I start with this case. This case, he is about 60 years old, man. So he come to my clinic after 3 months after COVID already. So he definitely have long COVID. So he actually from another province and he have a COVID. When he have a COVID, he doesn't have really bad symptoms. He never in the ICU. But after COVID gone, he have a problem breathing and it's gradually getting worse. And when he come to my clinic, this is the X-ray. You can see only some part of the X-ray, which is the black color, that's the normal. And in my clinic, so what do? With for him, we did the blood work. We try to find out any infections, so he doesn't have infections. And we did a CAT scan, and turned out to be he have a lot of fibrotic scar.
So this is the scar that you mentioned.
Yeah, right? The scar on the bottom of the lung, right? So so on the lower part of the lung. So he. After we have to admit this patient because he come walked to my clinic with oxygen saturation just 80% on room air. And then he's come with his own car. I don't know how come, but we have to put him on oxygen right away in my clinic.
He must and feel really exhausted then.
Yeah.
Well, in case some of you are not familiar with the oxygen saturation, well, actually, I think we are gaining more and more knowledge about that because we all have like the tiny machine that's like shouldn't be less than like 95, 96, something like that. Maybe people with lung disease will have like some 90 plus, but 80 is way too low. Okay, back to you.
Yes. So this cat, we doubt what is the process why he have so bad oxygen saturations. So we did a CAT scan and I think he have a fibrotic scar and part of that is what we call organizing pneumonia too. We try to rule out all of the infection already. So we start the treatment for him, and this is the X-ray after few months after the treatment.
Mm-hmm.
You can see on the right side, the bigger one is look more black color, which is mean more lung, and lung is more expand too, and fibrotic scar is decreasing a lot, and his oxygen level from 80%. Last time he came to my clinic, which is a week ago, he walked to my clinic, no oxygen, and he sat about like 95, and he can do small exercise already. So what do we do for him?
Now?
Yeah,
he can exercise now.
Small exercise, just walk good distance now.
Mm-hmm,
so he recover very well. So we try to combine the evidence based treatment, but we know that not much evidence based at this point. I'm gonna tell at the end what do we do for him, okay?
Right.
And another case, we got another patient. He's younger. He's just 40. He never had the COVID vaccine before.
Mm-hmm.
He showed up to our hospital with his X-ray. So definitely he have a small lung volume. And it's the more white is more, it means that worsening the COVID is, right? So after the treatment of COVID, he still have this X-ray even worse.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
Yeah, this is day 33, I remember, because this is the last X-ray before I send him home with this X-ray.
Wow.
We send him home this we did X-ray and I prepare everything at home for him. He have home oxygen. We have all medication treatment. I have the phone number that he can connect to me right away. And then he get through the COVID already. He doesn't have any more COVID, but this is what COVID leave to him.
I see.
At the point that he have to on oxygen 5 liters to go home.
Mm-hmm.
And then after I would say a month. So we start him on the medication too, the bronchodilator, some steroid and anti-fibrotic medications. He back to my clinic, he walking normally too, but he still have chest tightness. He's getting a lot better at the point that he can support his family a little bit. So this is what happened. So the treatment for the COVID, after long COVID, I think for the airway majority we do the bronchodilators. For the support for the chest tightness, and this one he have it. And sometimes I use the inhaled steroid, which is the medication to suppress problem with the airway for the patients. And another new evidence, I talk about the post-COVID that there's some definitions and something going on in the lung.
Oh, wow. So that reminds me of biology class now.
So I think just summarize. So when patients have COVID infections, a lot happened in the lung, and part of that is destroy the cells surrounded in the lung and then leave the scar, right? So in my clinical questions, what do we do with this? So I find out that the pathway that cause of the scar is similar to another lung disease.
Mm-hmm.
So actually, almost 2 months ago, 2 years ago already, we start from COVID, from the first wave in Thailand. I start using the medication anti-fibrotic,
mm-hmm.
which is in some particular case.
Right.
And now I think the people around the world kind of agree with that. Mm-hmm. Many clinical trials running to check which one is the best.
Right.
They not said which one work, but they said which one is the best. So it means that both of medication probably work.
Right.
The medication name is like pirfenidone or nintedanib that we use here, but it really depends which one I pick medication, just depend on the lung conditions.
So it differs between patients to patients,
yes,
right?
Yes, and then they have some basic science research
mm-hmm.
behind it, why I pick one or another one.
But well, you need to go through like the test, the CAT scan, all those things, right?
Yes, exactly.
The lung function test. Like it's not like if you have the symptom after COVID and you can go to the drugstore and get those medications by yourself.
No, this is this medication have to be monitored because they have some liver toxicities and then it's very high cost too. So we use in just mm-hmm. some patients that need it, and it seems to be work really well here.
But at least there's something that we can do, right? Because go back a couple of years, maybe this is not the thing that we can talk about at all. Because since we have the scar, it's going to be there for the rest of our lives. So this is like a new hope, that a new knowledge that we can get from like COVID pandemic here.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Well, this is like for the chest symptoms and a really great two cases. I know there's more. I know there's more.
Yes.
But besides from that, since we know that around like 50%, maybe they would have this kind of complication, but there's going to be the rest that is going to have like the insomnia that we they find it really hard to sleep at night.
Right.
And maybe it's like brain fog, they cannot think really well, or depression, something like that. There's going to be like lots of organ involvement.
Yes.
So moving on from our post-COVID clinic at Bamrung Rat, there is a what we call a post-COVID solution that we have conduct with Vital Life and Rang Kachao. Dr. Norin Thorn, what do we do there?
So we try to develop the program that can help to recover from post-COVID symptoms.
Right.
And we know that from the three mechanisms that I mentioned earlier. Mm-hmm. The first is poor oxygenation or hypoxia.
Right.
Hypercoagulation, the too much blood clot in blood your clots. Small mm-hmm. vessel. And the third is inflammation from cytokine storm from your own immune. So these three mechanisms leads to the way that we think what is the right solution for that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, right now there is no clear guidelines about treatment of all the long COVID, but there is many research go out every week, every 2 weeks. But the one who have a poor oxygenation, we have many kinds of treatment and machine that can give more oxygenation into the cellular level, like hyperbaric chamber or ozone therapy. The way that we help for the coagulation, there is many medicine or many kinds of supplement that can mm-hmm. Prevent blood clot. The basic one like fish oil can help to reduce the blood clot.
That's what we all know, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And for the inflammation, we have many kinds of treatment and supplement that can help for antioxidant, for get rid of inflammation from the body.
Mm-hmm.
So with this concept, now we have the solution by many modality. We also have traditional medicine and conventional medicine combined together. The one who have lung problem is not only in the lung, but it's about the chest wall. Now, if we can do some rehabilitation or exercise that can expand the chest wall easier, now it can help to the lung function too. Now, acupuncture is another treatment that mm-hmm. can help to balance overall energy in the body. Now, about the infusions, now we have an IV treatment infusion that we add some mineral and nutrient and antioxidant to get rid of inflammation in the body. Ozone therapy is another treatment that we try to add more oxygenation into the blood. And then it can clear infection, can get rid of inflammation, and can give more oxygenation in the cellular level. Hyperbaric chamber, you all know that is the chamber that have the oxygenation add more the pressure of oxygen more than the atmosphere about 1.3, 1.4, 1.5 times.
Mm-hmm.
So when you go into that chamber, your body get more oxygenation. So this is the way that we try to find the advanced research or paper together with the concept and mechanism behind this. And we have the another branch in Raksa, in Rang Kachao, about 40 minutes from the center of Bangkok. It's called the Lung of Bangkok. In the Rang Kachao, we have the area that we have the health retreat in Rang Kachao called Raksa. And at Raksa, we have combined all of these treatments and solutions into the post-COVID-19 program at Raksa. So we aim that we during the program over there, both the healing environment over there and the treatment that we design can help our patients to have better quality of life and can back to their daily life. So this is the program over there. That we have a Vital Life Scientific Wellness Center over there, Holistic Wellness. Medical gym that can provide some exercise program and rehabilitation program. Healthy food, anti-inflammatory diet, tea lounge with organic tea, and nice villa for rest and relax.
Now you're about to make me hungry with that picture.
So this is the environment and facility in Raksa in Rangkachao.
It looks almost like a resort, right?
It's a, we call health retreat. Right. That's combined medical, combined traditional medicine and medical gym together. And we try to create an environment and try to educate our guests to have a healthy lifestyle. This is a machine that called cryotherapy, cryo sauna, minus 130 degrees Celsius for 3 minutes. This one is a hyperbaric chamber that can lie down inside about 1 hour. We also have a hydrotherapy. This is a traditional medicine, medical gym, acupuncture, and yoga by the lake and in the villa. So there is the facility that can support and can help our patients, our guests, to be more healthy and both mental and physical.
Sounds like a good place to be after you have spent time in the hospital and in the ICU, right?
Yes.
It looks like that. And well, we need to come back to some of the treatment, but before that, I think we have like some question here. Well, besides from like the good afternoon from lots of you, there are some question that from SM Shafiqul Islam, excuse my pronunciation if I didn't pronounce your Facebook name right. He said, I think I'm suffering from irregular heart rate after recovery from COVID-19. Is there any relation between this problem and COVID-19? I believe the answer is yes, but I'm going to let Dr. Shok answer this question first.
Yes, there is some report about the fast heartbeat is very common.
Right.
This is a medical term called tachycardia, so they have some fast heartbeat after COVID. Infections in long COVID is called for the long COVID, but you have to make sure you don't have really kept heart problem. You have to see the cardiologist too. Don't just blame this is all from post COVID, but something have to be found out before we just say this is from COVID.
I think at, in our clinic we have seen some patients that come in with fast heart rate and or irregular heart rate.
Right.
In that case, well, you need to check like the lungs, the blood test, and the ECG sort of thing, right?
Right.
If they find that, if you find they have irregular heart rate, what do you do next?
So if it's really irregular, I usually I try to find out any other cause of this.
Right.
We have to see the structure of the heart. I usually send to cardiologist.
I see.
They did sometimes stress test, echocardiogram to see anything else that we need to be done for the treatment.
So this might be one of the advice that you need to do, okay? If you're not looking, if you're not seeing a cardiologist yet, maybe you would need to go to them and to make sure this is like post-COVID, which can be gone in the long run or it's going to be like there and you need like really treatment for heart disease. There are two consecutive questions here that are also from Mr. S.M. Shafiqul and Moshe Rahman, that can a patient positive at RT-PCR test after 2 months affected? And that time, what treatment is needed? It means like I you have repeated tests after 2 months and it was still came back like detected, something like that. Is it possible and is there anything that needs to be done?
So the best doctor to answer this, I gonna move to infectious doctor, but anyway, in my experience, some patients still have test positive after a month or two, but we have to see what exactly the number in the RT-PCR, how high of the virus, or the test is too sensitive to detect the virus, and it's just the part of virus, but actually you cure from the virus already.
Right.
There is some report that patients have reinfections, but majority not reinfection really quick, like 60 days. But in my experience, I have seen in my another hospital that I work to, 70 days they reinfect already.
I see. Okay. So it depends on the symptoms, right?
Right.
If you have like the repeated test came back positive or detected without feeling anything, maybe it's just like the remnants, the residue of the disease that was there and nothing needs to be done then.
Yes. Mm-hmm. For example, I have my patient that I try to send for the test, like lung function. Sometimes, some hospital policy, we have to do the RT-PCR.
Right.
The test is still come back positive after 2 months, but it's very low viral load, and then patient have no symptoms.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think we have to go too far to check all entire virus is it still intact or not. That's another test. So we just said this is most likely it's just some residue of the virus after COVID infections.
Mm-hmm. I see.
But it really depends on the symptom. Yes, yes,
from
sir.
My experience when right. I have a COVID patients, I don't wait until they got long COVID or wait until 3 months and give the treatment for antioxidant for right. them. So what I give, even for the healthy people, I think this one is good. If possible, you can check your vitamin D level, check your zinc level. If it's too low, you can supply or take this supplement.
So it's a simple blood test, right?
Yes, simple blood test. And there is many research show that the one who have COVID with vitamin D deficiency or low zinc level is higher mortality and more complications.
Mm-hmm.
So once the one who have COVID, I always prescribe vitamin D, zinc, and acetylcysteine on neck. Actually, this one help to relieve the phlegm or sputum. But it's also help to detoxification process at the liver to get rid of inflammation.
Right.
Quercetin is another antioxidant that can help to reduce the post-COVID symptom.
Mm-hmm.
And fish oil is also good, and finger root in Thai is called la chai. It's one of the Thai herb that can help to get rid of virus in the in vitro. So I think don't wait until you finish from the treatment of the COVID infection. You
right.
can start
Three
immediately.
Months.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
So it could happen like you can do it before it like 3 months already,
yes.
and you have to wait until like 6 months before you get better, right? So the quicker we start, it's going to clear it out quick,
right. Get rid of inflammation and less complications.
That will help a lot.
Yes, so we have the we call post-COVID supplement. Now it's a formula that combines of all of these ingredients in the formula at Vitalife.
Can we have that in Vitalife at
yes.
Bamrungrat
yes.
or we need to go to Bangkajau?
At Vitalife in Bamrungrat also have a post-COVID supplement. And
I
for
see.
The one who don't infected yet but like to boost your immune system, we also have a vitamin called immune defense supplement to boost your immune system.
I see. Well, according to you, what the details that you gave me, I need to tell you guys who is listening that myself as a doctor, actually not every doctor that knows how to deal with the inflammation, and also the dose is varies between patient to patient, and some of them we must treat them as supplement or as a medicine in a way. So don't try to find like all those by yourself, okay? You would need to like do some blood tests to make sure what kind of dose or medication that you need.
Mm.
Or well, if it's too much, there's going to be a side effect as well, am I right? And there are another question from Arif Khan. Patients affected with COVID-19 8 months ago, but still he feel fatigue. Is this post-COVID syndrome? I think Dr. Rinton, you should answer this one.
Yes, I think it's possible to be post-COVID syndrome. Anyway, I think we have to assess again by check the blood test to check all the condition in the body. Some case, there is imbalance of the hormone after the COVID infections. Some case have very high stress until the hormone in the body is imbalanced, like adrenal hormone or DHEA.
This is quite interesting, Arif Khan, if you have like the symptom or the details, if there is anything that you have been tested before, you can send in this live session, okay? Besides from the hormone, is there anything else that we need to like take care of?
It's again back to the concept of the three concepts, oxygenations, hypercoagulations, and inflammation. So we have to clear all of that too. And you have to start to gradually exercise. And try to take a high nutrient diet, healthy diet to let body get enough nutrient to clear inflammation by yourself.
Mm. Well, there's a, I'm going to skip some question a little bit, but I'm going to go back to you, okay? But it's like more a consecutive question. From Kalamurama, after COVID, patient feel some time breathing trouble and weakness. I think it's like more like a breathing difficulties. What should he or she do? Dr. Shok, would you recommend if they have breathing problems, they need to come in for check their lungs first?
Yes, I believe so. When the patient complain that they have a problem breathing after COVID, I would say they should come to see a doctor and right. least check their lung by their listenings, mm-hmm. get their oxygen level checked, and if something really seems to be abnormal, they have to go further with a more like X-ray imaging to see what do we deal with to start. And then the medications or the treatment is gonna come after we know exactly what happened at that point.
Mm-hmm. Right, okay.
And I think if it's clear, yes. no abnormal finding from this, mm-hmm. I think they can come to get the hyperbaric chamber.
The oxygen, right?
Yes, and oxygenation, I think, is another way that we can support.
Yeah. Okay, so they would feel better then. Another question from Ayan Rahman. Which food and fruits are best for post-COVID patient? Who is going to answer this question? Yes. Is it you, Dr. Narinthorn?
So, back to concept of inflammation. We mm-hmm. know that many kinds of food that can create inflammation in the body.
Because I see that you have like special chefs that is going to do like the cooking the right. food for that, right?
So, the food that you should avoid is sugar. Because sugar can create inflammation in your body, a high fat diet. But mm-hmm. what
so
you
they
can
need to avoid like pearly milk tea.
Right. That's really high sugar. In okay. one cup is about 8 teaspoons of sugar. Every day women should not have more than 6 teaspoons of sugar. Male should not more than 8 teaspoons mm-hmm. of sugar. Mm-hmm. But if you have one cup of
bubble tea,
it's already too much. Or even one can of cola, also about 8 to 10 tablespoon of sugar.
So this is not just post-COVID patient, right? Actually, it's for all of us.
So what should you eat?
Yeah,
you should have more vegetable and probiotic. Is also good. There is some research about probiotic and COVID too.
Mm-hmm.
It shows that probiotic can boost the immune system and balance and clear inflammation from the body. The food that have high probiotic is yogurt. Kimchi, natto, or the fermented tea like kombucha. These kinds of food can increase the probiotic or gut microbiome.
Oh, good, there's a lot of choices.
And if you like to have fruit, try to have more berries. And don't forget to have a high good fat like avocado, nuts, salmon, olive oil. This is a good choice for you.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay, that seems like a superfood list, something like that, right? I think this is going to be like the last question about hyperbaric oxygen therapy. Do you provide hyperbaric oxygen therapy in Bumrungrad International Hospital?
Oh yes,
as well?
we have both at Bumrungrad and
you
we
have on both sites.
Yes,
right?
At Raksat. Yes.
Okay, so it depends on the convenience.
Right.
Something like that.
Can choose which one we like to go.
Mr. SM says, thank you, Doc, and thank you for your valuable answer as well. I think, I believe that these two doctors has a lot more to talk about. And if you really want to talk to like them or our doctor team that take care of post-COVID patient, well, in our chest disease clinic, or in Vital Life or Vital Life at Rangkachao. You can book for like a telemedicine session first if you're not like don't want to come into the hospital right away. So we can make plans of, okay, what tests are you going to need, or is there any preparation that you would need to do, okay? And this is going to be a really valuable information for you and for your loved ones. And if you have not done that yet, don't forget to download the Bumrungrad application from the Play Store or the App Store and add with Bumrungrad official line so you can get like more information on that. And we can now do a telemedicine and do the appointment with the application as well. And don't forget to click like and of our Facebook channel. And so you don't miss another like session like this, because we know that COVID is still with us, and now the post-COVID cases, it's now growing and growing because the infection is not like stopping yet. And so, oh well, please take care, and thank you so much for Dr. Nguyen Thorn and Dr. Chok for this valuable session. I've learned something, even though I'm a medical myself. And don't forget to take care. And I guess that's the end of our session today. Thank you so much for everyone.